welcome to Kuala Lumpur Badminton Stadium for day three of competition at the OSIM BWF World Superseries Finals, the year-ending finale to the 12 tournament Superseries throughout the year. There you can see all 12 tournaments, and it was the results from those 12 tournaments which have determined the top eight players and pairs who are now here in Kuala Lumpur to contest these Superseries Finals. Now, just to remind you, the format: the eight players or pairs divided into two groups of four. Everybody plays everybody else within the group, and the top two go through to the semi-final knockout stage. So today is the last chance for players to qualify for those all-important semi-finals. We're starting with men's doubles, and the number two seeds, H.Endo and H.Hayakawa, they're up against the now disbanded Korean pair of Go and Lee. Then women's doubles and the world champions and three-time defending champions here of the Super Series Finals, Wong Xiaoli and Yu Young. They're up against Pearson and Aruta Yul. Both those pairs have already qualified. It's a question of who tops the group. Then mixed doubles and the Olympic champions, number one seed Zhang Yang and Zhao Yunlei. They're up against Mr. and Mrs. Adcock, recent winners, of course, of the Hong Kong Open. Then women's singles and the number two seed Sina Nawal. She's yet to win a match at these Super Series Finals, but she could still qualify for the semi-final stage. She has to win today, though, against the number three seed, Bae Yong-ju of Korea. Then we finish off this afternoon with men's singles and the three-time former champion here, Lee Chong-wei, the current world number one. He's up against Jan Jorgensen of Denmark. And similar to the women's doubles, both these players have already qualified for the semi-final knockout stage. So there's an awful lot of people been sitting, calculating, myself included, as to who could qualify, what they have to do to qualify. But here we can see the two groups, and it's a Group B match. Now, I can tell you that the third pair on that list within the group, Hashimoto and Hirota, they played one match, their first match against their teammates, H.Endo and H.Hayakawa. Sadly, Hirota got injured and therefore had to withdraw from the tournament. And that means that in essence, Group B, there are only three pairs. The way it stands at the moment, if the Koreans, who haven't won a match, were to win today, then the three remaining pairs will have all won one match and lost one match. Then it becomes complicated, and that's when I'm going to need my co-commentator and friend Jim Laugesen to help me calculate all the various permutations of who could win and how many points they need. It's all very, very complicated, isn't it, Jim?
It's very complicated. There's so many scenarios that can play out. So we have to see what happens, and then we will take it from there.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, of course, all the players in this tournament, there has been a little bit of a change since last year, because if you win your group, you are seeded in the knockout stage, and obviously with only four players or pairs in the knockout stage, and then there's a draw. It used to be the case that if you were top of your group, you would play the runner-up of the other group. Now the two runners-up in each of the groups are drawn as to which end of the draw you will be. So there is a possibility. For instance, in the men's singles, we know that Lee Chong-wei and Jan Jorgensen have both already qualified from Group A. And there is a possibility that they could play each other today and again tomorrow in the semi-final, which does seem a little odd.
It is a little odd. And I don't think I've ever tried that, and I don't think they've tried that before themselves. So it's going to be interesting to see what that brings to the game.
Yeah. Well, one thing is absolutely certain in this first match that we've got, this men's doubles, this Group B encounter between the number two seeds and this Korean pair, the Korean pair in the blue shirts, Korean pair, number four seeds, Go Sun-kyung and Lee Yong-dae, of course, played seven Super Series tournaments together before disbanding their partnership, and they've therefore finished the year at number four. Six finals from their seven Super Series tournaments, and the pair gets disbanded. Crikey, they are setting high standards in Korea, aren't they? So First of all, let's look at the number two seeds. Kenichi Hayakawa, the 27-year-old on the left as we look at them. Hiroyuki Endo, who's going to turn 27 on Monday. How wonderful for him if he was contesting the final of the Super Series finals once again on Sunday, the day before his birthday. Because, of course, last year they were beaten finalists in Shenzhen against the Danes Bow and Mogensen, whom they have already beaten in this competition this year. So you can see seeding of two, world ranking of four. And looking at their matches so far, well, we can ignore Hashimoto and Hirata because in essence that is wiped from the record books, because as I was just explaining, this group now in essence just three pairs. So the only result that will count for Endo and Hayakawa is that one against the defending champions, three-time defending champions, Bow and Mogensen. So as far as the calculation in the group is concerned, it's only that 21-18 and 21-15 victory that counts in the calculations. So to Go Sung Hyun, the 26-year-old, and Lee Yong Dae, 25. As I was saying, well, seven Super Series tournaments, six finals, two titles, ended up ranked number four. The world ranking still remains high, but I think perhaps what we ought to talk about in a minute, Jim, is Lee Yong Dae, because of course he has now formed another partnership and Young Sun. But as far as their matches so far, of course they've only played one match. There we can see the walkover given against the other Japanese pair, Hashimoto and Hirata, and they lost to Bow and Mogensen in two straight games. So the scenario is, if the Koreans won in two straight games, then it's very, very complicated indeed, because the three pairs in the group now would all have won one match and lost one match, and won in two games and lost in two games. So then you come down to the number of points won and lost. So it is going to be very complicated. Well, that suggests that the Koreans obviously have the favourites tag in this match, given the fact that this is the fourth meeting and they've won the previous three. But it all has become very, very complicated.
It has. Also exciting.
Yeah.
You can say if the one thing that will finish the excitement pretty quickly is, of course, if the Japanese pair should win the first set, first game, then.
Then they qualify, and the Koreans are out.
The Koreans are out. Yeah. So.
Yep.
It's only a matter of the Koreans winning in two sets.
Yep.
That's where we begin the counting of points.
You have brought your calculator with you, haven't you?
No.
Oh, Jim. There's our tournament referee and our technician on the instant replays review system.
Ladies and gentlemen, nine calls. On my right, Kim Sung-hyun, Lee Yong-dae, Korea.
Thank you, Chen. Matches, Jim, about how the Koreans like to play with a slightly slower shuttle. They're so good at defensive play. Now, I know that was a generalization, but to me, when I watch this particular Korean pair, Lee Yong Dae is such a wonderful front court player. He reads the game so well, but, and having seen them play so often in the past, they got to world number one, of course, now dropped down to world number two. But, you know, I think that once they have good offense, they're going to want to attack.
Yeah. It's a little bit different, I think, when Go and Lee are playing together. I think one of the reasons why they formed a new partnership with Lee and Yong is that Yong is a bit of a service situation where Go and Lee was depending too much on the other game, you know, the attacking and the defending. And we've seen Seteva and Asan in this tournament, and you won't have rallies like this. Mm. You won't get out of the first three shots. So I think they've shown more in that area, Lee and Yong, than Lee and Yong could.
Yeah.
But a very impressive start.
Yeah. And let's talk a little bit about this man, Lee Yong Dae, because I've mentioned the fact that with his partner of today, they played 7 Super Series tournaments together. Lee Yong Dae himself, wait until we can see Lee Yong Dae, because we're looking at Hyakawa at the moment. Lee Yong Dae, of course, has played 11 of the 12 Super Series events. The only one he missed, there he is at the back of the court, was the Japan Open. And of his 11 Super Series tournaments he's played in 2013, he's reached 9 finals, winning 5 of them.
Yeah.
Now, if there's ever an outstanding player in world badminton in this last year, in men's doubles, it's got to be Lee Yong Dae.
Yeah, it's fantastic. And sometimes you can, you know, you're thinking, he must be tired, or, you know, he always brings his A game. It's very impressive.
Now, the Japanese pair, if you're a Japanese fan, what's a little ominous is the fact that they've never taken a game off this Korean pair in their 3 previous meetings.
No, I don't think the style suits them. I think the Korean pair are too good in defense. So they have a good. The Korean pair has a good way of moving them around court, and then when they come into their favorite game, which is, you know, front court stuff, Lee Yong Dae is just, fantastic up there. I won't say he's the best up there anymore, because we have to take into consideration with Setteman. So there's a few up there competing with him. I think that at one point he was the best, but I think there's a few out there now that want to gain that title as a front court player. But he's still up there.
It would be rather ironic, wouldn't it, you know, that Koreans won their last tournament that they played together before the partnership was disbanded, the China Masters. If they were to come here and win this tournament, and they're still a disbanded pair.
You often see that happen, because now, you know, they're more relaxed.
Yeah.
And it wouldn't surprise me.
No.
They're good badminton players.
Well, first and foremost, they've got to win this in 2 straight games.
Yeah.
If they drop the game, they're out.
Yeah.
Even if they were to win this way. And that's got to be their focus.
But I think the reason why, and I know it's a tough one, but I think the reason why they were split up was they were looking for a pair that could win a title at the Worlds or an Olympics, and I just don't think the Koreans believe that this pair could do it.
Yeah.
And that's more down to the service situations, where I think Yong is much better than Go is.
Oh, my goodness.
About this.
Yeah.
And they're not used to that. We saw it yesterday, that Carsten and Matthias couldn't do that. But they're just so good in defense. It's a trademark of Korea, I think. The defensive is unbelievable.
Well, I don't think that either of us are particularly surprised at the Koreans leading at the mid-game interval. I'm just racking my brains and trying to calculate if they won not only in two straight, but won very easily indeed, then the Japanese pair may miss out on the semi-final place. So.
That's difficult for the Japanese pair, because even that they're not going well right now, they should be only thinking about one thing, that is to try and win.
Yeah.
Don't sleep on that. We can get this point, many points, you know. Focus on trying to win, and not even say just need a set. They need to try and win it.
On that point you've made, my mind immediately went back 12 months to the men's singles, and a countryman of yours, Vitinkus, was playing the last of his group matches, and he calculated he only needed to win one game to get through to the semi-final. Absolutely went for it in the first game, won his first game, and then sort of his mind went. He was so happy, he knew he was going to be in the semi-final. When it came to the semi-final the next day, he had obviously had to play three games. Instead of getting on with winning the match in two straight, he went to three games. He was so fatigued for the semi-final, he couldn't really... And I just thought, why didn't he focus on doing exactly what you have just said? Don't worry about whether you've got a game or get on and win the match.
It's also mentality, you know, you get out of your zone, you know, when you're in a tournament zone, you go in to win every match.
And yeah. Look how he's lunging forward, and the whole positioning and body language of the two men that you saw at the net there.
Yeah.
One's up high, taking the shuttle early, the other one's crouching down in a submissive sort of stance.
Well, it just reads the game so well.
Yeah.
There you see again, moving them in Ingo really, really playing well.
I wasn't sure whether that had crept over or not, but it did.
Could hear it on the screen. Controlling the shuttle so well.
Still got a healthy lead, though. Well, we have no idea what was said there or what that was about. I assume he wanted him to play on a little bit quicker.
Speed up the game. Good return for goal. I actually think some of the things I think that he was challenged on a little bit and why they split up this pair was he's been really good at in this match. So you see, you can just see how much it means to be relaxed. And that's one of the things, of course, when you do get the chance to play with top class player like Leon Day, there's a lot of pressure on you. He just seems a little more relaxed than I've seen. See, he's technically turning the game around constantly.
Yeah.
So
and we've got to remember it's not just Leon Day's status as badminton player,
it's a huge name.
A huge celebrity in his home country and throughout most of Asia, in fact.
Yeah.
Yesterday, didn't we, with the Japanese pair? A measured attack. Placement involving the net player. Japanese had their national championships last week, so they've had a fair amount of badminton. Rackets. Didn't sound too healthy, did it? Oh.
defense though by the Japanese man. Team J is just too good. So difficult to get away from when he's in that position.
Oh. Shuttle seems to be a magnet to his racket, doesn't it?
And he's controlling it. We've seen.
Game points. I have to say, the Koreans look very, very impressive in that opening game. Could hardly fault them in
from
any
the start,
area.
From the start, they were ready.
Yeah.
They came out of the start. The block is quicker than the Japanese. So maybe they're thinking a little bit too much about it. So many options. Still
whether they would actually accept the invitation to play in these Super Series finals, not only if they accept it, but the way they've approached their matches is absolutely first rate, and they should be congratulated on that.
Yeah. They just show up like they're still playing together, so it's good to see. And you can see why the Japanese parents have trouble with him playing against Lee Gohan, especially Lee. He said he's just too good at the net. So the type of game that the Japanese pair wants to play, he's just closing down.
One criticism I have, you know, of the Koreans and Lee Yong-dae, his defensive stance there as he was defending, he was on the double service line back in the court. Needs to try and stand his ground, because just occasionally, despite the fact that he is incredibly quick, when players then do just block it, he struggles to get forward.
Player, when you get that, you have that feeling there, that's nothing better.
Rudy Gunawan, he used to play that cross court shot, you know. Well, it's been lost from the men's game for a while, I think.
It hasn't been used for a while.
No.
And one of the reasons for that, it has been that the style has changed a little bit. Yes, I've seen before time you saw a guy was standing in the front and one in the back. You often see the front player move out of the cross defense. I think the pair that really started that was Jonas Aspers and then Lars Bosket. They kept moving out, so that cross that came from there was actually not the best shot you could use.
No, in fact, you played yourself into trouble with it.
But it seems like now it's turning around again. So now players are aware of the cross cut. It's not going to come so much. So they kind of cover one side of the court, so it's becoming a shot that can be used again.
Challenge of the day.
Yeah, but here we saw Lee was looking, and normally they would probably be arguing, but Go was actually saying it's good.
Yeah,
it was in, so no point of
asking.
And I like that. That's a good thing in badminton. That's a very, very good thing.
Thank you.
It's a little bit of a... can't let this gap open up too much.
Seems to be exaggerated at the moment. I'm wondering whether the rain has started outside.
It has started raining outside.
So,
drizzling at the moment.
Yeah, just looking through the curtains at the top of the stadium here. A bit of daylight, but it does look fairly dark. So I think it probably is raining at the moment. But more importantly, we're at the mid-game interval. 2-point advantage to the Koreans. And it looks at the moment as if it's all going to come down to points difference within the matches.
I'm glad I'll bring that up later.
20 seconds. I was speaking to some of the tournament officials beforehand, we were going round in circles, all the different permutations that could happen with the matches we've got this afternoon, and who could qualify, what they need to do, and we were getting more and more confused. We were confusing ourselves, I think, in the end. But this is simple in that if the Japanese pair could win a game, they qualify, and so do the Danes. For the Koreans to qualify, they have to win in two straight.
We have to remember there's two guys sitting back home, and sitting here in the venue and watching this as well. That's Matthias and Carsten.
Yeah. are they actually?
They're probably just as nervous as.
Yeah. Do you think they're actually here, or are they back in the hotel?
No, I think they're back in the hotel.
Yeah.
They're just as nervous as these four players are.
So there's fault called. Racket not pointing in a downward direction. So it's Kelly Mora.
Thank you. fantastic shot. Instead of going for the hard shot, he went for the cut shot. Look at that, takes the pace off. You can see the Japanese guys all the way in the back. That's a beautiful shot.
Especially as he played that off balance.
Yeah. And for the Japanese, that's just the worst that can happen for them, because they're gonna have to move a lot in their defense. To the sides and go into play. Just like that. It's not Go's favorite position to be in the front. So they need to find a way to get him up there. Get Lee away from the net. Easier said than done though.
Between the
Japanese and the
Danes as to who joins them in the semi-final. Well, I'm sure the Japanese know that every point is going to count.
Oh, yeah.
Very nervous. good match. Played with good intensity. The defensive play of the Koreans outstanding, in that it time and time again got them out of trouble before they could go forward and win the points from the front of the court, as they so love to do. 21-13, 21-17. 36 minutes. So, three pairs in the group, each won one and lost one. Each won in two games and lost in two games. It's all about the calculators and the number of points won and lost. That's the first of our matches concluded. I'm busy with my calculations at the moment. I've sent Jim Laugesen down to the tournament referee to get our calculations confirmed as correct, so I don't want to give them to you as yet until we've had that confirmation from the tournament referee. Next up is women's doubles, then mixed doubles, women's singles and men's singles. We'll finish off. And for our next match, the women's doubles, both pairs have already qualified for the semi-final stage because they've both played two matches and won two matches. So you can see the others in the group, the Thailand pair of Duanganonga Rinkison and Kunchela Voravichi Chaiko.
This is Christina Pedersen, the winner of the Women's Tournament.